Your budget too.
You have an Apple phone, right?
Do you have to tell me?
I'm thinking of.
It is wireless.
Oh, we at some point gonna review Tri-Tech?
You want to?
Well, I mean, I know, but it was that part of the plan too, or part of, we were gonna do that?
Well, now I was going to continue with the mind and thoughts and how to live with thoughts day to day.
Yeah, and the, good, good. Maybe next week or something, was it Tri-Tech?
Yeah, I can, you know, a good review of Tri-Tech is when I teach the people here Tri-Tech.
Oh, on, during an evening out class?
During the Tuesday and Thursday classes.
Okay, I'll watch it. I'll watch it on the,
Next Tuesday is Tri-Tech, what I'm going to teach. So if you watch that.
You'll get it, okay.
You'll get it there.
So now, since I have to leave at 12, do you want me to leave now?
No. At 12, you just say it's 12 and we, and you leave.
And then just jump up and push everybody away.
So anyhow, sorry.
Sorry.
This is hot.
Anyhow, I find out now what happened.
What happened?
Well, she tried to commit suicide.
Ay.
So the police came, she wouldn't open the door. She threatened the police with one of these things. So the police, you know, that know how to deal with these situations. There was a policeman there that was like 2 hours speaking with her little by little. And finally, the policeman managed to
talk
her down and take her to the hospital. So she's in the hospital now.
Well, she's safe now.
She's safe.
She's got a peace of mind. Yeah.
She's safe.
Was that her first attempted suicide?
No. It's about the fourth.
Oh, God.
Mm.
That's good. That's
good. You need a Benito?
Especially when you're out far away. And I thought I had.
Yeah, so this is like perfect. Because it's all,
So shall we start with a couple of minutes meditation?
All right. All the essentials.
Sometimes we get up to all the essentials.
All the essentials.
Need to say we're very happy.
Shanti, Shanti. Open your eyes slowly. Namaste.
Namaste.
So, I'm going to start with I'm going to dedicate the day to something which is we teach all teachers in Spain, which is the different things that Guruji taught about the mind. Understanding the mind is important, and understanding the mind gives you somehow power. You have power over the things you understand. If you understand how something works, you have creative power over that. If you don't understand how it works, you really have no. It's it's something that you have to think about. You don't learn it in a moment. You have to think about a lot, and you have to realize it in your own experience. But I'm going to use all the different ideas that Guruji gave about the mind, and I'm also going to include how, you know, neuroscientists and people of the like really kind of say the same kind of things. Mm-hmm. But I'm going to start with the simple part, which is how to deal with thoughts, so that will give you time to at least go with something. So, you know, during one day we have, you know, thoughts. During the day, this is a discipline. Remember, a disciple comes from discipline. This is a discipline that you put yourself on yourself, that, you know, you obligate, you say obligate? You mm-hmm. obligate mm-hmm. yourself to it, in the same way you obligate yourself to be at 9 o'clock at your job, or you obligate yourself.
Commit, like sort of a commitment.
Commit, you commit to that. And in the same way you commit to other compromises, it's a commitment that you do with yourself, that you are going to apply this discipline to the day. Mm-hmm. If you really do it, you will find out that works, and quickly enough. As Guruji said, I mean, you can do the whole thing in 6 months, you know, but you have to be on it all day in 6 months. So you start your day, you start with your good morning day. Whatever you have to speak, you that are teachers, tell it to Guru Raj instead of telling it to your mother in your imagination, or to your father, or to your friend, or to whatever you want. You need to speak it with him in the first hours of the morning. Do your first meditation. If you need a prayer, do a prayer. If you need an affirmation, do an affirmation, but do your pranayamas and tratak, the least. And then start the day, and then you have, we saw it yesterday, 15 hours of actions. Good. But that you have, you can just apply, you know, what they call now, and it's very popular, you know, they call it mindful actions. You know, act mindfully. Well, you know, you have 15 hours of actions to act mindfully. Mindfully means, and to really do it mindfully, you have to create, you have to devote yourself to the action, which means you forget about the result, forget about if you like or don't like the action that you are going to perform, just stay with the action and do it as an offering to God. Simple. And put yourself in it. And you know, if you need to use the mantra to keep your attention, you can repeat the mantra. For example, if you are peeling potatoes, you can also be repeating the mantra to keep your attention in the potatoes. You, each one can find its own way to keep your attention brought back to the action, but it's basically the same thing you do when you do the chant. You bring your attention back to the chanting, you know, your thought goes someplace, but you bring your attention back to the chanting one and another time again. That's why the chant, you know, takes the pressure of the mind, because as you are moving this articulating language without saying nothing, and these muscles are connected to the same precortical frontex where your verbal thoughts are generated. In fact, verbal thoughts are connected to these muscles. That's why people, when they are thinking, they might speak. You know, you are thinking and you speak because it is connected to the wires are connected. So the wires are doing, are moving this, saying nothing. The mind is thinking verbally, and it makes it easy to let the verbal thought go because you go back to the action. Well, in the same way you do it with a chant, you do it peeling potatoes or you name it, whatever the action you are performing. So you have those 15 hours to practice, you know, actions, in mindful actions. But then you have thoughts, you are thinking all the time. And there are certain thoughts that don't harm you, and there are certain thoughts that harm you. There are four kinds of thoughts that have a distinctive neurobiological signature. So if you do an electroencephalogram or this brain imaging technology, they have, you know, it has a pattern, these four kinds of thoughts. And the four kinds of thoughts are creative thought. So when you are creative with your thought, I don't know, you are planning a vacation, you are writing a poem, you are composing a song if you're a musician, you are planning the term for if you are a school teacher. When you are creating something, creative thought is doesn't harm you. And you know, when you are creative and you are in the situation of creative thought, you know, time kind of, you don't have idea of time going by, time kind of stops, and you are there, you know, in creative, so that's good, no problem in that. Then you have contemplative thought, when you contemplate something. You can contemplate, you know, a sunset, you can contemplate a song, a music, you can contemplate an opera. If you read or study something, it's a kind of contemplative thought, because contemplation is your mind flowing uniformly through a very one thing, no? So you are contemplating, for example, a sunset, and you are perceiving the smell, the different colors, the change of colors, the air, and you are just contemplating. That is also a thought that doesn't create any problem. You could be contemplating an idea also, you can contemplate many things. And there are many techniques that Guruji spoke about throughout his satsangs that are not taught, you know, like kind in the regular techniques, but that has to do with contemplation and with contemplative thought. So I will speak about those techniques also throughout the day. Then there is the meditative state of the mind, which is meditation. I don't need to explain to you. That is a situation where you just keep returning back to the knower, to the experiencer, to the observer. So, you know, you just let everything go and go back to the state of being, you know, the observer. The eye that is observing, which is your consciousness. And then there is the mind chatter, which is what makes you suffer. And the mind chatter is composed of lies. You know, in your mind, if you keep attention to your chatter in the mind, you will find out that you lie a lot to all the people you speak with. Tell them lies. Of some description. So, you either lie. So you know when you are, for example, having a shower and you are, say, directing your talk to your mother and you're saying, no, mommy, I don't smoke now, I have left it already. You know, it's not true. But you kind of, you know, getting indulged into those kind of conversations. So you either lie or manipulate. So in these conversations, you might want something from someone. So you will start a chatter, and basically you are exercising in the manipulation of the other person. You all recognize these patterns, yeah. Right? Three.
No, I never.
No, not me.
Number one.
Everybody does that. Everybody does. You know, and if they say no, if they say no, means they are very, very unconscious about this. The third thing that you can do, is this, in this mind chatter, is project yourself as Superman or Superwoman. You know,
all the time.
Yeah, you know you are. You know you are mentally speaking with this man you like or this woman you like, and James Bond is nothing to your side. No, so you know, projecting yourself as what you are not.
So is that egotistical?
Eh?
Is that egotistical or
no? All the little eyes do these things. That's the nature of the little eye. The little eye that we all have does these things. It's the only thing it does. It was built during your teenage years.
Prehistoric.
And since then, and since then, it's doing exactly the same thing. And many people have not left it if they are still in the teenage
time. Right. I don't even realize it.
It's the only world we live in. Are you kidding?
Well, because I think it's fun to be naughty.
Yeah.
So you are either projecting yourself as what you are not, you are telling lies, and what is the other thing? Let me remember. There's a fourth thing that you do. You are mindfully projecting yourself.
Maybe
or
you judge.
Yeah, exactly. Judging or complaining.
Is that a lie?
Yes, judging.
That's the
or
truth.
Complaining.
Complaining.
So, if you look at these characteristics and you go and see any program, any real, how do you say this, like Big Brother is watching, I mean the Big Brother program?
Yes. Person of interest.
How do you call this? No. How do you call these programs that are reality shows?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Reality shows.
Awful.
Exactly. If you look at any reality show, you will see that these are the components of any reality show. So in Spain, there is a channel that is reality show channel, which is TV5. So I call the mind chatter the TV5 mind mode. So I don't know if there's a channel here of reality shows, but if there is a channel of reality shows, that's the mind chatter. That is what makes you suffer. Now, how do you deal with that during one day? Because you have to deal with that during one day only. So you have to simplify the situation to say, it's only today I have to deal with this mind chatter. And what are the typical things that this mind chatter does that you want to stop? And it's important to stop. to learn how to stop this mind chatter? Well, the typical things that you do is the following. You do the first thing that is typical that we do is, how do you say here in English in the court when it is a very quick case, like a summary judgment?
A quick judgment.
No. Well, a quick, yeah, quick summary. Judgment, which is basically this kind of thought. For example, you are at home and your husband or your wife, you know, you meet in the kitchen and you see your husband and your mind thinks, the fucking arrogant. Because he has said something, but you say nothing, you just fucking arrogant. So it's a quick judgment, summary, no discussion, and you say nothing. Can you relate to that all these quick judgments that your mind does? Right. The problem is that you start with your husband at home, but then you leave the house and you see, I don't know, the guy, and your mind thinks, whatever.
The asshole.
The
asshole.
This stupid asshole, dirty as always. And you think, and then you get in the car, and you go driving, and you know someone with a big car, you know, overtakes or whatever, and you think. And then you start seeing one asshole after the other. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And one asshole and another. And by the time you finish the day, you have seen 150 assholes.
Nice.
It builds. It builds because you don't let it go.
And you think they are assholes. Yeah. But it's not the case. Yes. So, a very simple technique that, if you practice it, works. And if you practice it for a while, not much, no more than 2-3 weeks probably, you will stop doing quick judgments. And it's a release when your mind stops doing quick judgments of this nature, which is the following. It's very easy. Every time your mind says so and so is, whatever the judgment is, you have to immediately look at yourself and ask yourself how I am the same thing I'm looking at. So you think your husband is an arrogant and your mind says, so you immediately look and ask yourself, how are you being arrogant now? And if you do that, you will find, if you are honest with yourself, you will find it immediately. You will immediately find that you are just projecting that energy which is active in you in that very moment. And you do that, and you keep doing that every time your mind makes a quick judgment, and in no longer than 2-3 weeks, your mind realizes that it makes no sense. And then it does it automatically. When your mind sees an arrogant, immediately you look at yourself and you correct. So you understand this technique?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So this is one of the techniques. Another thing that we do with the mind is when we get obsessive about someone or something. You know, this is what we call the anti-Matilda practices.
Anti-Matilda?
This is the name Guruji gave to, you have them in many satsangs.
Anti-Matilda?
Anti-Matilda practices.
Yeah, so it's not waltzing Matilda.
I will put you a video about Guru Raj speaking about these practices.
Yeah.
Anti-Matilda.
So it's anti-Matilda.
She always said, say Auntie Matilda The practice is defined, for example, Auntie Matilda said you a bad word that morning. Mm-hmm. No? So you go out from your house and you say, and Auntie Matilda, how Auntie Matilda has told me this, because I'm so good with Auntie Matilda, and Auntie, how she does tell me this, and you go with Auntie Matilda, Auntie Matilda, Auntie Matilda, and you can be hours with your mind creating negative thoughts about Auntie Matilda. You pick the example, no? When you get obsessive or you get very angry with, normally it's a family, it could be your husband, it could be, you know, whomever. You understand that? You relate it with your own experience? You can find a relationship? You also, Susie?
Yes.
So, what do you do with the Auntie Matilda practices? Well, first that I start with this, the main technique is the following. And this is what really, what you have not to forget about what to do with thoughts. Thoughts, a positive thought, and negative thoughts are, you know, you have to balance both. So you have positive thoughts, negative thoughts, positive thoughts, negative thoughts, positive thoughts, negative thoughts. And this is like an account of a bank. Every time you have a positive thought, you put money. Every time you have a negative thought, you draw money. So if you end up the day in the reds, like in this case, like in this example, it produces the same sensation that having the account in the bank in the reds. So you're like this. you are constrained, okay? And at the end of the day, when you arrive at the end of the day, here, you feel that you've lost the day, you feel life is terrible, and you really feel bad.
Spiritually bankrupt.
Exactly,
if
because
balance,
you are bankrupt in thoughts.
If they're in balance or if they're on the negative side?
If you're in the negative side.
Oh, yeah, okay.
No, if you're in the positive side, you are okay, you know? But if you are in the negative side, you are unbalanced. And what you have to be able to do is keep the balance that day. And keeping the balance that day, you forget about, you know, whatever you have done in the past. You have done it in the past. And the circumstances is a reflection of that. So what you have to do is, you know, accepting that those are the circumstances you have to live in, keep the balance that day. And the following day, do the same. Don't create additional bankruptcies by simply balancing positive and negative thoughts.
So, now, Roman, are you saying at night you have to reflect back on your day to do this?
No. I don't believe I have said
it. No, don't reflect.
No, I'm going to, this, you act
it's
real time. This
current.
Is real time. Okay. So your mind thinks the arrogance of my husband, and you look at yourself immediately, that very moment, not during the night.
I know that, but I'm saying that at the end, do you look back and say, well, I was more negative today than
Well,
I was?
If you are aware, this, one of the things that this technique does is keeps you aware of your thoughts. And by being aware of your thoughts and conscious of them, you immediately recognize it, because that consciousness that is conscious within you is the divine consciousness in reality. Mm-hmm. So that consciousness knows what is a lie, and so you start discarding thoughts. You start discarding, and it works, and eventually you discard them all. So basically what you want is to keep the balance, which means, you know, when a negative thought, you know it's negative because it produces a contraction mm-hmm. of the muscles. Mm-hmm. You know, it could contract your abdomen,
that's
or
right,
you can
stomach.
You
yeah.
can
I feel it in
press your teeth,
stomach.
Or you can
headache or your shoulder,
frown mm-hmm. or in your shoulder. So it produces a contraction. So you are in the kitchen, and when you say the arrogant of my husband, that goes together. Well, you are putting the, you know, the orange, you do it with a little bit more pressure, no? So you realize that if you have a thought that produces a contraction, you are aware of that and you compensate. And you compensate with a positive thought. So you want to, if you know, if I am 10 seconds thinking negative thoughts, you can spend the 12 next seconds thinking positive thoughts. This is the main technique that was taught by Guru Raj in many satsangs. Now, to do this, they are, you know, additional techniques to achieve the same end, which is you want to arrive at the end of the day with a at least balance zero, at least balance zero, and if possible, a little bit of money in the bank, no? But at least balance zero. So one of the problems to get this balance zero in one day is when that day you get angry with someone, for example. You know, you had a quarrel with your son or whatever, and then you go out and my son, because he's this, because he's that, or how he dare, and and you can be there for hours. Some people stay in that state for days in a row. Mm-hmm. So you have to be aware if you suddenly see yourself that you have gotten it with Auntie Matilda, and you know, say something happened in your house with your husband, and you take the car and you are the husband, and you arrive to your job. And by the time you arrive with your job, you are still with the husband, and then you realize you have to start your job. And you realize that you've been thinking negatively about your husband since you left home, that was 9 o'clock, to now that is 10 o'clock, say 1 hour. So you have to commit yourself to compensate that hour of negative thought with your husband. How do you do that? Well, there are many ways. One of them is, for example, you go to work and you have to start doing other things, so you cannot sort the situation then. So you have to tell to your mind, so that your mind gets at ease. Say, look, you have not yet finished killing your husband. So we will leave your husband for later. Now you have to work. Forget about your husband, we will kill him
when you get home.
When we get home.
You put on the head.
In other words, you don't tell your mind that it has not to think that about the husband. You just tell the mind that, look, not now that. I have other things to do. I will finish killing my husband afterwards, later. And then you plan yourself, you plan. You know, if you've been 1 hour thinking negatively about your husband, you must plan at least an hour and a quarter or an hour and a half to finish dealing the situation. So, you know, if you are leaving your job, say at 5, you can say to yourself, well, look, at 5 I'm going to walk, and during this walk I'm going to finish killing my husband. So you do what you had to do at your job, and then you go and do, for example, a contemplative walk. And what you do is the following. If you do it walking, which is a good way of doing it, you just start by walking and breathing two steps, breathe in, two steps, breathe out. So you start, you know, you find the rhythm where you can walk. It could be 2 and 2, 2 and 3, 3 and 3, 1 and 1, depending the speed you walk or the place you walk. If you find a place to walk, the nicer the better. You can do this also sitting down with yourself. So there are many ways, but walking, it's a good way of doing it.
You know, and just to add something, you know, they say when you move emotions. So that's really, it's an added.
So what you do is, you know, you let the pressure that could still be there. So you bring your husband back to your mind, and you know, You are so angry with him for whatever reason. You are so angry with him that you know you need maybe another 5 minutes of bullshitting him in your mind, so you let it go. You have one thought in the back of your mind, which is, I'm doing this to not to kill him, but to liberate myself of this. And once you take the pressure, you do a temporal walk of your relationship with that person. So you go, in this example, which is your husband, to the first memory you have of your husband. When you met him, say you met him in university or whatever, you go to the first memory you can recollect in your mind. And you pick the first good memory you have from your husband. There must be good memories there. Even when you are very angry, it takes a while to find the first good memory. But you know, if you look for it, you'll find it. And once you pick the first oldest memory, good memory that you have, you look for the next one. And you just, you know, if you've been an hour and a quarter bullshitting your husband, you spend an hour and 20 minutes finding from your memory, recollecting from your memory all the good things that are in your memory about your husband. In the process of doing this, not only you compensate all that negative thought with positive thought, but these exercises brings you to an understanding, a different understanding of what has happened. And once you acquire this different understanding of what has happened, the normal thing is that when you arrive home, your husband says, oh, and I'm so sorry about this morning. You know, I was a little bit out of myself. So if you sort it with yourself, the other person sorts it also, because it's synchronous. So this is a practice which is, Guruji called it the anti-Matilda practice, but the essence of the practice is keep an eye on your negative thoughts and compensate them with positive thoughts, which, for example, could be, you can be thinking that my company is going to bankrupt, no, say. And you are, my company is going to bankrupt, what I'm going to do, and you start getting, and you realize that you've been the last 15 seconds thinking that. Well, look at the positive side. What is the positive side of my company getting bankrupt? I'm fed up of the company and anything is good, so that would be. This might give me the opportunity to dedicate myself to teach meditation full-time. Good, that could be another positive aspect of the same situation. In other words, you do as this film in Monty Python, the Life of Brian, yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, when he says, look at the bright side of life. So, you can do it that way, looking at the positive. Any negative thing has a positive side to it. They always go together. If you cannot see the positive side, because sometimes we are so attached to negativity, we attach very easily to negativity, yeah. Much more difficult to positivity. We are so attached to negativity that sometimes we cannot see the positive side. There is no positive side for us. Well, then repeat your mantra, for example, or try to think about something else, or compensate the thought. This thought and communication go together, because the communication, verbal communication, is thought expressed verbally. So this works also with your relationships and your communications. If you say a bad word to your husband this morning, doesn't matter. Tell him two good words before the day ends. And you compensate.
Check and balance.
Mm-hmm. Check and balance, exactly. So you keep balancing the situation. You keep balancing your thoughts. Once you learn to balance your thoughts, first of all, you become aware of your thoughts. And second, for example, you start you stop doing quick judgments. I tell you, I had to do the anti-Matilda practice no more than 6 times in my life. Because after the 6th time of doing it, I never got angry again with anybody. Like to, you know, like never, ever. So I don't need to do it, but because once you do it, you realize that it's a trick of the mind. When you get angry with someone, in reality, you are thinking that that other person should behave differently. And you are no one to say how people should behave. I mean, people behave as they behave, and they are what they are.
We have no control over that.
And you don't have control over that, so, I mean, that's it. I mean, you love them as they are, not as you would think they should be.
But can I ask you, so the practice of, all right, so you see your husband or whoever, and he's arrogant, and you say to yourself, what am I? And you'll see the arrogance in yourself. But can... isn't it a good idea to also practice it if you see goodness in someone, to then see that goodness in yourself, or is that harder to do because it's positive?
Look, the problem of that, of becoming good, is that you may be too good. I mean, it's no good to be too good.
Is that a lie?
No, it's not a lie, it's truth. I mean, you don't want to get too good. You know, you really, the little lie always wants to be...
Humility.
I'm so good.
Best.
You know, all this,
and
oh, I see this person, and oh, it is that I am lovely also. No, you really, what disturbs is negativity.
So if you
just balance it, it comes to a point that you don't need to feel good, like that you are good, no? The problem is when you feel bad because you think the other is bad, but in reality you are feeling bad.
You
are projecting the arrogance in the other one, but the one that is feeling bad is you in reality. Mm-hmm. So you have to sort that one out. If you only see beauty, you don't need to do the act of saying, oh, I am beautiful, because you don't need it. Mm-hmm. The beauty you see around you is good enough. You don't need to think that you are beautiful.
It's like Vivekananda says, you know, with the chains, right? You have a gold chain, and so you use the gold chain or something to pull out the bad stuff. In other words, balance the bad stuff with the good stuff, and then throw both out. Because...
Right.
Yeah. Well, I guess if you're just balancing the negative, you're going to be left with the positive anyway.
Yeah, if you're balancing the negative, what happens at the end is that eventually mind chatter practically stops. It practically stops.
And I think it's also from what we learned as teachers is that you can actually say doing this, you're actually, now you're using your mind, and your mind is not using you anymore. And you have this practice, it's us using our mind instead of the mind using
exactly,
us.
Exactly, it's dealing with thoughts. I mean, at the end of the day, we are speaking of, you know, people that come to meditate, they come because they suffer. I mean, everybody comes because you suffer. You suffer because you don't see God, or you suffer because your wife left you, or you suffer because you don't have money, you name it. Mm-hmm. But you suffer. So
self-inflicted.
So what we teach is a tool to get rid of suffering. Mm-hmm. And this is a tool, and where do you use this tool? In the day you have to live. And where do you use this tool? With your actions, with your thoughts, and with your feelings, which is what define your day, which is what define your life, because your life is none else than the result of one day after another. And that's it, so you deal with your day, which is where everything is happening, and you deal with your actions, with your thoughts, and with your feelings. And now we are with the thoughts, no? And we've gone through, and it's time for you to go.
Get out of here.
I'll watch you.
So get out of
here. You probably heard him say that the money is a useful tool.
Too late.
It's a horrible matter.
So Ramon,
that's exactly it.
Thought is just a thought.
I mean,
it's not negative or positive. It's just our perception on it. So
All emotions are produced by thoughts.
Yeah, right.
Emotions are produced by thoughts. I mean, when you feel fear, is because your thought is telling you you're going to die tomorrow, or you are going to be left without money, and you believe that thought, and then you feel fear. So it's not nothing. Thoughts are things, and thought is something that is manifested. In fact, I will give you now the view of thought and of the mind of Guru Raj, the one that Guru Raj gave in his satsangs, but which is common to the Eastern tradition. And in, within the Eastern traditions, the mind is something. It's not, you know, we tend to think about thought as empty holes in the empty space, you know, like it, they were not things. Thought is things. Thought is information and is a thing and is manifested. And the mind is not in the brain. The brain perceives the mind, but is not the mind. The mind is information, and the mind is all over around. I mean, it's like the, this universe, but in mind, in another dimension. But it's as big as this universe. It has all the information from the universe. It, as it is something manifested and physical, eventually the scientists will be able to measure it. They are, in fact, today doing the first hypothesis about this. And there was recently an article published in Nature, written by Sir Roger Penrose, which is a Nobel Prize in physics, and another neuromolecular biologist, because they are trying to relate the functioning of certain neurotransmitters, some description of neurotubules that have a very quantic behavior with, you know, scientist things. But they are trying to capture, they are going in that direction. And eventually, it will be measured. But for you to have an idea of what is the mind with respect to the brain, in this room, and I always use this example and it's very graphical, in this room there are thousands of vibrations, things that are vibrating here, with all sorts of information. You know, people speaking, people running, stories about, you name it. And I could demonstrate it now to all of you. You want me to do it?
Yes, for sure.
Put a radio here, any radio receiver. Yeah. And if I put the radio on, I put one channel, someone speaking about this, another channel, someone speaking about that. Put a TV here. And put one channel, another channel. Where are the voices? In the radio or here? They are here, vibrating in the magnetic field. They are vibrations of the magnetic field. And with the radio, I receive them. And you know, when the materialistic, positive scientists say the mind is in the brain, they normally tell you, well, look, if you have a stroke in your brain and you get this area with which you speak fucked up, you cannot speak.
It's a technical term.
if I put an electrode and then I activate this thing that is with what you perceive yellow, you start seeing yellow colors. Mm-hmm. So, and you know, I do all these kind of things, so everything is in the brain. Because you know, if, which is like if I say, look, imagine I have a TV here. If I take the green, the circuit of the green, you stop seeing greens, and then you see the picture without the full color. And if I fuck up the sound, the circuit of the sound, you don't listen nothing. So, the images are in the TV. No, the images are not in the TV. The TV receives, perceives the images and translates them into images, but the images are here and there, the same images, and all around. Well, the mind is the same. It's information that is all around, and you connect to the part of that information that is your part. It's like a telephone.
The brain is the same or the mind?
No, no, look, it's like a mobile phone, a cell phone. All cell phones, all calls go through the same spectrum of, it's in the 1600 megahertz, I think, no? It's so, they are all there. They go, if it is through cable, they go through the same cable, but it only rings when it's for you. Although they are all in the same place. So the individual mind is more or less the same.
The individual mind.
The individual mind is your mobile phone, but the mind is where all the phones are. And that's where the information is, really, not in the phone.
Right.
So it's that concept. So,
it's God calling on line two. Tell him I'm in a meeting.
So how is it that the mind, how is it that the mind works?
So you're saying there's the individual mind and then there's the universal mind.
In the same way that there is the river and the ocean.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that was good.
Because it is exactly like that.
So it's a field. It's a field of information.
Exactly. So the mind, there are many ways to represent the mind. And I'm going to use the different ways that Guruji used in his satsangs to represent the mind. And he did it with a blackboard also, by the way. So this is one of them, where you have the mind is connected with the universe in 3D, let's call it, with the universe, you know, the manifestation. This is the individual mind. And in the same way that there is the universe, the material universe, this would be the universal mind, which is like the universe, but only the information. For example, we could say that the universe is composed of energy and matter, right?
Is that on the left?
Universal.
Universe.
The
universe, I mean.
3D,
plus time. This place. we can say it's composed of energy and matter. In the Hindu traditions, the universal mind, which is like the universe, but information, when it is information, it's prana and akasha. Prana is the energy and akasha is the forms. The different forms, and the different forms is the information. This is just academic, philosophical, so that you know where the words come from, right? But imagine this universal mind as the ocean. This is your individual mind, which is the river, and this individual mind is connected with the manifested world in 3D through two channels. One channel of entry and one channel of exit, one channel of entry, which in yoga are called the Ida and the Pingala. Which means you have an entry channel. What is the entry channel with the universe of the mind? You must know it, that. What is the entry channel of the mind with this universe? The senses, I mean, you perceive the universe through the senses, through the eyes, the ears, the... Okay, so the senses are here, and you perceive the universe through the senses. So that's the input. And how do you act over the universe? What would be the exit of this? How do you act? how do you act over the universe? I mean, in the world with the muscles. I mean, you move your muscles to write a letter, to speak to someone, to punch someone, to get your car. So these are the muscles. You act over the universe, moving your muscles. So it's, you know, like for example, in the example, you touch an iron with two iron, and so you touch, you receive the heat, it goes in through your body, so it goes with the nervous system, goes to the brain, the brain, and then gives an order to the muscle to take the muscle away. So the input channel is through the senses, the output channel is moving your muscles, right? You see your friend in the street, the information enters through the senses, gets processed, and you respond saying, "Hello, John," moving your muscles. Okay, so that's the input and the output. Senses is the input, muscles is the output. Mm-hmm. Then there is another energy here, which is one direction only, that is called, in yoga it's called Sushumna. Right. So, and the individual mind is this thing here, right? So, the universe that you perceive is the universe that exists in your previous impressions. And this is very simple to understand. Why do you put that face?
Sorry, because I lost you already.
Okay, look. The universe you see, the world you see and you conceive,
okay,
is just based on your previous impressions.
Exactly.
It's very simple to realize. Imagine you were born deaf, blind, no taste, no touch, no hearing, no nothing, no senses. Imagine you were born without senses and that they managed to keep you alive all this time. Tell me, what would you know about this universe or your life or your parents?
Nothing.
So, the only thing you know is your previous impressions, which means that when you see an asshole... there is an external event here that is composed here in your... So this part of the brain is what the Hindu calls manas. And what the scientists call this the sensomotor system.
Causes you to reach for the toilet.
So this event creates information. It is composed in the organs of the senses in this part of the brain, which is chitta, which is the memory box. And you know, this is composed and then it goes to the memory. And when if you say, "Oh, an asshole," in reality, what you are perceiving is your asshole. You understand?
Yeah.
It's just your previous impression that you are perceiving. You are not perceiving but a previous impression in your mind. And your mind has said, "Oh, this is this." But you really don't know if your mind is playing tricks with you. But that's what happens, okay? So, this is like here, when any event that happens outside, you know, will generate, a lot of information. Some of it will be conscious, and some of it could be unconscious, for example. For example, say you are walking in the street, and you see your couple walking by the hand of another person, and you know, walking very romantically, no? So you are there, you are walking, and you see the event. So you see the event, and you say, "Oh, that's John." Say, "John is your couple." So you recognize, you see the scene, and say, that's John. And who's that bitch? So you recognize. You make a recognition also.
Previous experience.
But you know, those memories are connected to other memories. The memories of John are connected to other events with John and could be connected to unconscious memory structures of things that happened in your family when you were a small boy or whatever. So this event activates kind of a chunk of information, a structure. You could be calling them samskaras. Activates that chunk of information. Whatever event, this chunk of information is activated and this information has been created. We will get into that this afternoon. We will not have time to do that now. So this package of information that this event has activated is goes into two places, this place and that place. This place of the mind is what they call buddhi. In Sanskrit, it's called buddhi. It could be, this is chitta, this would be the memory box. And the best word for buddhi would be the intellect, the light of the mind, right? Is the part of the mind that is connected with the universal mind. So it's the light of the mind and is the intellect. In the conscious part of the mind, what the intellect does is weigh the pros and cons of a situation. So this package of information gets generated through this event and then goes to buddhi that evaluates the pros and cons of the situation. Buddhi can ask for more information to the memory box and claim more information in this process of evaluation. And buddhi will send, so this is a back and forth path, and buddhi will send that information here, which this part of the brain of the mind is ahankara. Ahankara is the identity. You have the small eye. The identity is just a section of your memories that you've made yourself and you have identified with. And you start doing that when you are a teenager. You start doing that when you are a teenager. And there is, you know, you build this identity. And this identity is what gives orders to the muscles. In other words, the one that in this example crosses the road and punches the boyfriend or the bitch or that, you know, contracts and hides, that would be another possible reaction. You know, it's the I. It's I am doing this. It's the one that gives the order, which is the identity, ahankara. Now, what is the result? What is the behavior that this creates? Depends on the previous impressions. For example, if you are a woman born in Saudi Arabia, in Jeddah, your previous impressions will generate a package of information completely different to a woman in New York. Right. Yeah. And obviously, the pros and cons analysis and the identity associated will generate a completely different behavior. And all these things are automatic. What this means, right, is exactly that is the conditioned mind. Mm-hmm. You think you are in charge, but you are not. For example, for you to realize what I'm trying to say. Who here, any one of you here is supporter of a sports team, like the Patriots or
Yankees?
Yeah. The Yankees, right. So you support the Yankees because you have previous impressions that made you a supporter of the Yankees. Maybe your parents were of the Yankees, so. Right. Which means that if you are watching the Yankees against the Patriots, would be, for example?
No, Yankees against the Boston Red Sox.
Yeah. The Red Sox, okay. So if you are watching Yankees against the Red Sox, you cannot avoid getting happy if the Yankees score, and you cannot avoid getting unhappy if the Red Sox score. And there is no way that you can tell yourself, tomorrow you are going to watch the TV, the team, and you are going to get happy for the Red Sox, and you will not be able. So it's not in your hands. It's just a conditioned mechanism of the mind. In the same way that works everything.
Right.
Your sympathies, your antipathies, your attractions, your repulsions, your everything that you think that you are the one that is doing it is just a mechanism which works because of these previous impressions.
So basically you're saying we don't control the mind. We don't make our own decisions, it's the mind is making the decisions for us?
Well, what I am saying is that you have to inquire, who am I? That's what I am saying, because you are not the mind, you are not the emotions, you are not the body, so find out who is free within you. But what I can guarantee you is that you don't push your molecules. Your molecules move by themselves. I think I told it yesterday when I put this example of Pascal. So it's not you. It's what is so, it's not, well, it's not the you, because when people say I, they mean this.
Yeah, they don't mean. Oh,
hello,
we're gonna have to start over.
Wipe that smile off.
Oh, yeah. No more food.
But we can change, like we can say we're meditators, we can change our identity, and then our intellect.
No, you cannot change nothing. You can transcend.
Transcend.
You cannot change your patterns. You cannot change your impressions. You cannot change that. You
can
transcend it. What means transcend? For example, I am a supporter of Real Madrid. You know Real Madrid?
Yes,
the football team?
Yeah.
So I am a supporter of Real Madrid. Why? My father is a supporter of Real Madrid. Took me when I was a child to the Real Madrid stadium. And, you know, I am from Real Madrid. I've been conditioned to get happy with Real Madrid victories and unhappy with. So you cannot change that. You cannot tell to yourself, tomorrow you are a supporter of the Barcelona. Because, you know, I could try and I wouldn't be able to do it. But you can. What means that you transcend it? For example, when I see a team, you know, in the TV, for example, Real Madrid, Barcelona, typical, like Red Sox, Yankees, no? And you know, I live and I jump when they put the score and I insult the referee if it is needed. You know, and I enjoy it completely as a supporter. But the moment I leave the bar, and if you ask me 10 minutes after the game, what was the result? I have even forgotten. I say, oh, who won? You know, so it doesn't stick with you. Other people go to their home depressed and they fight with the wife because, you know, the Yankees lost or whatever the case might be. So you can transcend your impression. You cannot change them, but you can transcend them, which means that they stop affecting you. You stop identifying with, I am from Real Madrid. So if Real Madrid loses, I lose also. Once the identification is broken, the impression is there, but not being identified with it, you have transcended it. But it still operates. So you still get happy when Madrid scores a goal and you are watching the team, no? And that is, you know, you could generalize to any other behavior. So it's an hour and nearly a half now. So this gives me time to finish the cooking of the lunch, and we have lunch.
Okay.
And we'll continue with the mind after lunch.
I was just trying to put the Auntie Matilda practice in there and how that would work.
Well, you don't try to confuse yourself unnecessarily.
Okay.
You first try to, we will continue with this scheme and I will show you how this is created, how all these patterns, I will try to explain you how all those patterns come about. And how those patterns that come about and the circumstances you are in are like a mirror image. Your circumstances and the patterns with which you know and perceive your circumstances are like two mirror images. And I will explain you later how this happens.
Gracias.
And let's go to finish the...
Damn!
Excellent.
No, Benito is there already.
It's on the video.
Yeah.
Good.
Okay.